Hello everyone, and welcome to the Legendary Greenskin Campaign Starter Guide for Warhammer Total War. In this guide, we'll focus primarily on strategies, tactics, to help you in the initial stages of the campaign for the Greenskins. Because out of all of the factions, the Greenskins have the most, I'd say they have a very unique starting position because you can't exactly just turtle up, armor up, and get ready to just build up your economy and build up your forces. Instead, you have to be extremely aggressive with your diplomacy and with the battles, and every battle is extremely critical. Having done about 15 campaigns, this is essentially what I've got for you guys. You could pick Azak the Slaughterer or Grimgor, but Grimgor's starting units are essentially way better. The Black Orcs, the Doom Diver Catapult, and the Boar Orc Bull. Powerful beginner units, plus the campaign movement speed with the upkeep cost, makes Grimgor essentially the best choice. He will also be a very powerful general killing unit when it comes to all these early battles. Now, let's just looking at our starting position, we have a very unique type of beginning. If we attack the Red Fangs, you have to deal with two armies. The Crooked Moon to the south is going to get overrun by the Dwarves, by the Azul. To our north, we have the Bloody Spears, but they generally don't bother us because they're trying their best to quarantine the Dwarves to the north. Is it possible to expand your campaign to the southeast initially with the two Greenskin armies? Yes, you can. However, this guide will primarily focus on the campaign going northwards to contain the Dwarves. Because sometimes the Blaze Spears can't contain the Dwarves and they won't be a serious threat. However, due to the latest patch or just in general, the Dwarves are a serious threat and they have to be taken care of first. Build the your massive money pit first. Build the next level tier 2 building, barracks building, to get the Orc Archers. We will need that for the upcoming quest that is just north of Iron Rock. What has to be very important here is the destruction of this army. Now, while you could play it and just kill off some troops, killing off as many as you can is essential because the AI does about 3 different moves judging to what happened what you do to this army. You will have to play this battle and destroy as much as you can, getting down every unit to about 15 troops and killing the general. This battle is it's very simple to do. It's just the goal is to cause as many casualties as possible with your one cavalry unit and your heavy infantry. Since we're playing on legendary difficulty, we have a penalty in terms of leadership, and the enemy has a bonus in leadership. Using our best units to counter their units is essential in this battle. The Doom Diver Catapult will be using against the enemy's Orc Boys. They're essentially their best unit. What the Doom Diver Catapult will do is do a minus 10 leadership impact on the unit. So essentially what it does is it counters the legendary morale bonus. If you're playing on a lower difficulty, the morale impact will be more devastating and you'll be able to rout the soldiers much faster. Try not to chase after the archer units. You want to keep all these units as congested as possible so you can kill as many troops trying to run away. Having played this battle about 15 times, it's almost getting tiring, but I've almost like perfected the whole thing. However, you could go after the goblin chariots, but you don't really have to. Just focus on all the foot infantry. Have Grimgor fight the general, have the goblins chase the archers a little bit, and have your orc boys flank around and do a flank from the rear. Do a massive amount of morale damage. The Doom Diver Catapult Plus, the Black Orcs attacking the Orc Boys will devastate them. That's essentially the most dangerous unit that can cause some serious casualties. When the enemy starts to rout, try your best to get them down to about 15 soldiers per unit, because essentially when they're that low, they essentially just disband, and they'll no longer be a problem to you. What you're aiming for at the end of this battle is the general to be dead, and about 80% of the army to be dead as well. More than likely, the chariot will escape, and maybe one unit of goblins or orcs might escape as well. That's completely fine. One or two units escaping is not too bad. That's pretty fine. At this stage, the AI essentially do three moves. There is no exact way of what they will do. Send your troops back to your border, and you can actually replenish a little bit of some casualties. And you go, what's most important is you can actually build three Orc Boy units. Get yourself the campaign movements so you can get to Iron Rock faster. But at this stage, this is what can happen. The garrison at Iron Rock could come down, regroup with the army that you just destroyed, and they will more than likely attack you. Or, the army that you just destroyed might run for the garrison at Iron Rock and reinforce the army that's already there. Or the Iron Rock garrison can move completely west and completely abandon Iron Rock. The AI does a couple different moves, and it's very random. It's difficult to predict exactly what they will do and what they will not. However, you can hold your position here, and you should be completely fine. The worst thing that can happen is when they mobilize both armies against you. However, even though the auto bar looks pretty bad against us, you could still play this battle and you could definitely still win. And then what's giving you that huge advantage is because the fact you destroyed that army, you now have a very good chance in killing the remnants very easily. Most of the time they throw out shamans for that army that you just destroyed, which is an easy kill for Grimgor. You could throw some Doom Diver catapults to add insult to injury to the goblins, send Grimgor against the shaman, and essentially what you have is an extremely easy kill. I wouldn't worry about the goblin, the wolf chariots. There really are no threat. If they're harassing you too much, just bring up your goblin archers and just harass them. Your Orc Boys, Boar, can also catch them pretty well. The main army that's coming from Iron Rock, it'll take them a little bit of time to actually reach you, so no need to worry. You can take your time in destroying the Goblin Wolf Chariots. Easy. And they really should not do any impact to you. The great thing about the Iron Rock garrison is that it's mostly made up of goblins. And since you have the Black Orcs with the Immortal Banner, you have an extremely powerful unit that could just decimate the goblins, even with the leadership penalty. When you're using your Doom Diver Catapult, focus it on the best melee unit that the Iron Rock garrison has to offer, and that is essentially the Orc Boys. Charge all your units, focus on, and you should definitely win. Just focus on utilizing your cavalry unit to do as much damage as possible to flank from behind, because otherwise this battle could prolong, and it isn't in your best interest to do that because you're outnumbered essentially. Your Black Orcs will do well, but keep in mind this is on legendary difficulty, so the morale of the enemy units is extremely high. Let's get But yeah, with the Black Orcs breaking that line in no time, you could use them to flank around, and essentially, this battle's over. With this battle essentially done, you've essentially have a complete advantage over the Red Fangs, and victory is simply yours. With that victory, we can essentially go straight for Iron Rock with any and no resistance. However, go for the corner right just northeast of Grimgore here. If you go to that corner, you can build another 3 Orc Boys, and he'll be in range of attacking Iron Rock. You don't have to destroy the remnants of the Red Fang army. It is simply no threat to you. Their fightiness is low, and the army is essentially decimated. Now, in many of other campaigns, I would strongly suggest going down the blue skill tree, but the orcs, the greenskins, don't really have really any good particular skills. When it comes to legendary difficulty, it's better to go for the leadership tree, getting that extra leadership aura bonus, buffing your orc boys, is essential. It's very powerful in as well. At this stage, the Red Fangs can do 2 things. They can retreat to their southernmost village, and they'll just completely abandon Iron Rock. And here, and essentially, it is an easy victory for you. I'm the one true git. And what essentially now what we're doing is we're waiting and building up our forces for a quest battle with the dwarves to the north. You can decide what you want to do to Iron Rock. Maybe, I believe sacking is a good option, but the reason I chose Occupy is to replenish my troops a little faster to get them ready for the quest battle to the north. Now, do you have to do this quest battle? It's very optional, but the Goblin Big Boss agent is actually really nice to have. I mean, even though it doesn't give you like any, it's not like a wizard that gives like a discount on buildings or anything like that, or like a shaman, an agent can still be utilized pretty well. I mean, think of it as a spy. You can send it in enemy territory, keep track of enemy movement, and if you really need to slow down an army, the Goblin Boss could do that. Build 5 Orc Archer units. You'll need that, because for the battle against this quest battle, you're going to be fighting the gyrocopters. And since the Beastmen update, they've been significantly been buffed. They are definitely a threat, and if you try to go into that battle with just melee units, you will take heavy casualties, and you'll just be they'll be shooting fish in a barrel. Your one Goblin Archer unit cannot take on 2 gyrocopters and a gyro bomber. Thus, the need to have orc archers. Not to mention, the orc archers are really nice to have later on. Sometimes when you decimate the Red Fangs and take an Iron Rock, you could get a peace deal with them, but it's very random. We'll guarantee making peace with them later down the road. The composition of the army is almost complete. We'll just build 2 more orc archers, 1 orc boy, and get ready. Upgrade our shiny pit to tier 2. Because right now, all we're focusing right now is money and building the next war boss. The intention for the second war boss is to reinforce our southern front. Blackcrag, since we're playing on legendary difficulty, we have a large amount of negative public order, thus we need a secondary army to fight the rebels. But the primary reason in the construction of the secondary general is to save Karak 8 Peaks from falling to the control of dwarves. If the dwarves take that fortress, you're going to have essentially a very hard time later on, because it is a powerful fortress that you can recruit orc biggins, and it's got tier 2 defenses. thus it is not worth losing. I got a peace treaty with the Red Fangs, and it's worth taking. Essentially, later on, once I reinforce Karakay Peaks with my secondary army and destroy the Dwarven army that's coming from the southeast, I can essentially focus, put all my focus on going north, attacking Scabii and attacking the Dwarf factions to the north. A stack will be coming from Black Iron Mine very soon. It'll essentially be one stack full of Dwarf Warriors, Quarrelers, and Dwarf Artillery. Once we build our secondary army in Black Crag and bring those troops close to Karakay Peaks, it's best to make a confederation with them and then reinforce the garrison with your secondary army. It doesn't have to be a full stack, but it's good to at least have like half a stack. With our main army into the north with Grimgor, we can do the dwarf quest. Since we have the 5 orc archers and a good number of orc boys, we can definitely do this battle. Though it shows that it gives us a massive advantage on the auto bar, you gotta keep in mind, when you're playing legendary battles, the auto bar doesn't take into account the penalties and the buff leadership buffs that the AI get as well. Like, I will take some heavy casualties just due to the simple fact that dwarf warriors are better than orc boys when it comes to one-on-one engagements, especially on legendary difficulty. What I'm counting on is to simply use my massive numbers to surround the dwarves, break their morale, use the Doom Diver Catapult to break morale, and essentially utilize my archers to the best I can. This composition that you see right here is essentially what I've been doing for this battle quite often. You're going to have to use your Black Orc to counter their elite troop soldier as well, the Dwarf Hammerers. They are definitely like probably the biggest threat, and you have to use your Black Orcs to actually counter them. You'll use your Doom Diver Catapult to counter the Grudge Thrower siege weapon that the Dwarves have, and have about like 2 Orc Boys, the Goblins, and the Cavalry unit, Shock Cav, to fling from the right side and get around the enemy very quickly. And essentially this should be a good enough method to do. Just keep in mind, on legendary difficulty, you can't pause the game and issue orders, so this all has to be done very quickly. Have Grimgor fight the Dwarf Lord, focus your Black Orcs to attack the Hammers, and then you have to individually order your Orc Boys to attack certain targets. I'm not expecting to break their front line. The only way you can really win against Dwarves as the Orcs is you have to flank around and hit them from the sides. Focus half your archers on a Quarreler unit, so 3 archers per Quarreler unit, and you should decimate those crossbowmen before they have a chance to do any serious damage to your men. On the right flank, we have 2 Orc Boys flanking around. We could send them against the archers, but what we really have to do with them is to hit them in the flank. Hit the Hammer elite unit in the rear. Because look at that leadership casualty just going down. Like, my Orc Boys fighting the Hammer units already at half. They're about to rout. But once I hit them in the rear, the situation changes drastically. The Shock Cav are doing a good job cleaning up the artillery, the archers. I forgot to set my guys to guard mode. It'd probably be better to set them to guard mode right at the start, so you don't throw them into a melee fight. Use the Shock Cav to break the left flank. Those Dwarf Hammers are still causing a lot of damage, but it should be good enough. The dwarf helicopters should be coming in. Gyrocopters should be coming in soon, so you gotta get ready for that. Yeah, here they come. And here's a very interesting little fact. The thing is, the dwarves, even being surrounded, They could still be winning. However, with the gyrocopters dropping bombs in the middle of the blobs, not only do they do an impact of morale to themselves, they will do damage to me, they will drop the morale off my men, but it also hurts their own. So essentially, those gyrocopters do more damage to their own men than to me. However, the orcs have a lot less leadership, thus it impacts me a lot heavier. The gyrocopters are very random in what they actually target. You're not going to kill them very quickly. I mean, you need to focus all your archers, maybe half, three archers per gyrocopter. I wouldn't really suggest focusing all six. I mean, you could do that, but you're not going to kill them quickly. They will drop their bombs before anything else happens. However, once you do enough damage and damaging the helicopters with your archers and your ground troops continuing to do well, you will win the battle and it's essentially over. After a successful battle in the quest, we got ourselves a little bit of armor and we have the goblin boss agent. Now, keep in mind, this is essentially a spy, an assassin, and a saboteur. We'll essentially be mostly using him to assassinate, maybe block the army, to harass them from reaching a target too soon, and to use him essentially as a spy. From here, using him, we can see the dwarf stack that's still at Black Iron Might. It will be coming down to Karak Eight Peaks, and we need to save that fortress from being taken. It is a fortress you just don't want to give to the dwarves because it's just... I mean, think of it as the Black Gate of Mordor. Like, most of the time, the dwarves to the southeast side, they'll not dig under the mountain to reach Black Crag. Black Crag's garrison is extremely powerful, and Karak Eight Peaks' garrison is also very powerful. Is it worth doing a confederation? Personally, yes. So you could take control of the garrison when the dwarves are arriving. Let's go. At this stage, you could send your main army to go back, but on a couple campaigns, different situations can happen. At this stage, like, the dwarves from the north will be attacking the Scabii. They might actually be, like, doing a full blitzkrieg into Scabii the dwarves. I mean, it's very random in how they attack. But you might have to keep Grimgore to the north. It is not worth making a confederation with Scabii. I mean, realistically speaking, you will definitely, with legendary difficulty, trying to maintain control of the Scabii territory is just simply not worth it at this stage. It's better to make a confederation with the Crooked Moon, taking Karak Eight Peaks and holding that area down with your secondary army. The reason I'm bringing over Grimgore is essentially because he has a stack behind him in a wall. I want to wait for the dwarf to actually attack Karak Eight Peaks, but the AI is very smart. It knows that I'm like waiting for it to siege the city, so it's not going to attack it. And I was thinking, okay, maybe I could tunnel in my secondary army and reinforce Karak Eight Peaks from the north. Essentially bring in two stacks. With Iron Rock, focusing on building money generation buildings, I'm not really worried about money. If I destroy the dwarf stack, I could get a decent amount of money in the post-battle. I found it this time to be the perfect time to make a confederation, take control of the garrison at Karak Eight Peaks, but keep in mind, it's not going to be a full garrison. I'm not sure why, but maybe it's because of the confederation. Keep moving. Start the war. At this stage, I thought I had the area secure and I could just tunnel in to Karak Eight Peaks. Unfortunately, that gets me intercepted, even though Grimgore is right there. Thus resulted the elimination of this army. Though it is unfortunate that I lost my secondary army, which was supposed to be a garrison army, the army of Grimgore is still up, and it could still fight that dwarf stack, not a, without a problem. I'll take charge of the garrison with Grimgor. And it should be completely fine. It's just now I'm a little bit set back. So instead of tunneling towards the Karakay Peaks, if you have the secondary army still going, just force march it around. Don't try to tunnel in through. Crooked Moon always has that little raiding party to the southeast, but disband it so you can save yourself some money. And now you got the dwarves that are trying to tunnel away. You can generally auto and win. Even if you don't catch dwarves trying to tunnel away, try your best to eliminate that stack. Once you destroy that dwarf stack, you can definitely go into diplomacy and negotiate peace with the Azul dwarves to the southeast. Once you secure peace with them, you can then concentrate all of your Grimgor's army to march north to get ready for the dwarf threat. You need peace to your south front. Well, you don't need, but it's better not to have two factions harassing you nonstop, because the garrison army that you're going to be building with a new war boss, you're going to be fighting rebellions at Black Crag and Karak Eight Peaks. Now, you don't need a full stack. You can have like about half a stack, because you can count on the garrison, the powerful garrisons that both Black Crag and Karak Eight Peaks has. With a half stack, it's essentially one and a half stacks versus one when the rebellions go to full strength. So you shouldn't have no problem in controlling these areas. And on legendary difficulty, as strange as it sounds, it's good to have these rebellions because it keeps the fightiness of your army up to the point that you will generate a Wa army to follow your garrison army around. So there's no threat of both Black Crag or Karak Eight Peaks falling. And Grimgor and his Wa can focus entirely on fighting the dwarves to the north. Now in this campaign, they're pushing south very close, very rapidly. Skebii is essentially being destroyed, and I've got two dwarf stacks just north of me. This isn't really a problem. Unfortunately, since my secondary army was destroyed, I have to send Grimgor to destroy the rebellion. However, when you see Thorgrim Grudgebearer to the north, don't worry about it. Focusing on destroying the rebellion is more than likely the most important thing you should do for now. You should keep your fightingness up and give your troops some veterancy. You should take very little losses. But more than likely you would use your secondary army to actually fight this rebel stack, not the Grimgor. With Grimgor, you should be heading straight north and dealing with the dwarf threat. Now, luckily for me in this campaign, Thorgrim Grudgebearer is just building up his doom stack that is just north of Iron Rock. Now, if I sent just Grimgor, he would actually lose in a one-on-one in an auto. Maybe if you play the battle, you have a better chance, but Thorgrim Grudgebearer, like, he brings in, like, 20 units, and, like, 90% of his army is made up of dwarf warriors. So, but just by raw numbers, dwarves will win. But once you bring in the Wa, that's a completely different situation. I sent in my agent spy to see what's going on, and I see Thorgrim is moving towards the west. More than likely, he's trying to finish off Skebii. But once he sees the Grimgor stack approaching from the southeast, he is gonna do a U-turn and reinforce the village to the far east. I'm not even gonna try to pronounce that name. But he will try to save that city from being taken. Bring your Wa in range, and you essentially have two stacks versus one, and you will win for sure. Here, I'll just continue to use my spy to see where Thorgrim was moving. For here, I was just essentially building up my garrison. Just half of our half archers, half orc boys. It's a decent garrison, nothing fancy, nothing elite. I don't like goblins because they're just not really that useful when it comes to legendary difficulty. They might be expendable, but they're just not really not that useful. I do like how the dwarves completely just abandoned this village with the green tide. Is it worth looting? Not really. It's better to have my troops at full health than to get a little bit extra money. Focusing down the leadership tree to get more skills to help me in battle if I have to play one. Continue to use that spy to watch that stack army. Could we rush for the dwarf capital? We could, but it's better to deal with the dwarf threat to the west here. But at this stage, can this happen in your campaign? Not really. This is like one of the situations that could happen. And it's such a situation that you're trying to aim towards. Like right now, Thorgrim Grudgebearer is getting very close to Duk Karas. And this is what you want to happen. You want Thorgrim to go into a city and take the garrison. Because realistically, if you sent your one stack versus Thorgrim, you would effectively lose. I'm going to raiding stance so I can get ready for the next turn, so I could siege Duk Karas next turn. And the AI will see that, and they'll be like, okay, well, since there's a wall next to Grimgor, he's not going to attack you out in the field. However, what the AI is going to choose is the best option for defense. Thus, he'll choose to garrison it. This is what you want to happen. Because then you're going to send Grimgor, siege Duk Karas, or whichever village that Thorgrim chooses to hide in, and just encircle the city and wait for your Wa to back you up. Don't set a target for your Wa. Your Wa will follow you wherever the parent army is going. And once you're set, have the Wa follow. Let it reinforce you in your siege, then attack. There's a new rebellion in Blackcrag. Not to worry, we can continue building the garrison stack. Get it about maybe like 15 units in a stack. You don't need it a full stack, but it's your choice whether or not you want to do it. Let the rebel army siege Blackcrag. It will take them a couple turns to actually make all the siege towers and stuff, so you got time to counterattack. It takes the rebels about 3 to 4 turns to actually build up their full stack. And then they'll start sieging. And here we have essentially Grimgor, his Wa, and against Thorgrim Grudgebearer. Thanks to the Wa, the odds are heavily stacked with us, and we essentially have won the battle. From here, it's mostly just you're essentially just cleaning up the dwarves, destroying what remnants they have. Because once you eliminate Thorgrim, the dwarfs are heavily crippled. You can take whatever territories they took very easily, and you can then make a straight run for the capital. Once the capital, what you want to do with the capital is completely up to your choice. You can raise it to the ground. I will not disgrace my ancestors. But personally, you focus on your campaign to the southeast, but what you could do if you want to take a little bit more of a risk is you can loot and occupy. You won't destroy the gemstone building, which more than likely they have in the dwarf capital, and keep that under control. Just fix it up and try to maintain it. However, you're going to need a third orc army garrisoning the dwarf capital to keep the area under control up there. But, this definitely concludes the starting guide for the Greenskins. It's a bit longer than the other guides, but it covers a lot more details in how to effectively start your Greenskin campaign. When you have peace with the two factions to the south, the Red Fangs and the Azul Dwarfs, you can focus your campaign in controlling the Skabii territory and dealing with the dwarves. Once you eliminate Thorgrim Grudgebearer, you have about 5 turns before he spawns again. Like, I've noticed very often that when the AI have their legendary lords, they always have a stack, and they're extremely dangerous. When you eliminate a legendary lord, you have to quickly take over their territory as fast as you can. You can also use your goblin agent to harass the enemy, to assassinate, or just slow the army down, like this army that's in the Badlands. I was honestly harassing him with the agent for the majority of the time. And from here, it was very easy. Yeah, it was very simple. Like, the dwarves never had a chance to rebuild an army, and I was just focusing Grimgore attacking anything. But yeah, I do hope you guys enjoyed the video. I'll have a dwarf legendary guide coming up, and I'll have to be redoing the Empire and Vampire Count starter legendary guides as well, because due to the Beastman update, a lot has changed. Like, effectively right now, I'd say the hardest campaign in Warhammer Total War Legendary is Empire. Because the Beastmen, like, the AI seems to be even more aggressive than it was before. And the Beastmen, the main Beastmen faction, quite literally does a mad rush for Empire territory right off the start. Like at around turn 9 or 10, the two Beastmen stacks are going to already be at right glance, so. Anyway, that is the conclusion to this tutorial. I hope you guys enjoyed the video, and I'll see you next time.